Open the pod bay doors, please, Al.
God bless us, everyone.
These glowing words spoken by Tiny Tim have warmed the hearts of millions the world over. Now hear Tiny Tim and all the other wonderful people in this unforgettable story speaking their immortal lines as the most joyous of all Dickens classics reaches new heights of greatness on the screen.
Merry Christmas to you anyway, Uncle.
Good evening.
And a Happy New Year.
Good evening. Humbert! It's all humbug, I tell you. Mercy.
Pod bay doors are open. Thank you very much for joining us once again here during our festive Christmas season. I'm your host, Doug Heller, film critic and film historian for TalkMovieToMe.com. Joining me, as always, across the white-capped plains, fresh with pure-driven snow, is Jerry Dean Roberts, film critic for ArmchairCinema.com. ArmchairOscars.com, and I'm pretty sure he knows what snow looks like because he did grow up and he did spend some time in Ohio, but he's down in the... How are you, Jerry?
Christmas! Humbug!
It's a humbug. Today we're breaking our unspoken rule of the year and actually dealing with a movie that deals specifically with Christmas. And it's not just set at Christmas.
It's probably the most direct Christmas movie we're talking about, but it's not like Christmas Vacation or, you know, Christmas Story, which is the trajectory is Christmas Day and we're gonna, you know.
Right.
It's a movie very much a that takes place at the holidays.
Right.
That's what the theme of this month is.
Yeah. And it's 1951's Scrooge. Going with the on-screen title.
This has been messing with me because you picked this. Now, let me explain. Okay. When this came out in 1951, in the United States, the movie was billed as a Christmas Carol. Everywhere else in the world, it was called Scrooge.
Mm-hmm.
Except here. Okay, so when you picked this, I kept looking for Scrooge. And the only thing I could find was that crappy Albert Finney movie from 1970, the musical.
Yeah, that was terrible.
So I kept looking for this, and I kept finding Alistair Sim in A Christmas Carol, and I texted you like three times. Okay, which one are we talking about? You said Alistair Scrooge. Sim. And I said, you said Alistair Sim. I said, I think Alistair Sim was in a Christmas Carol. And you said he was in Scrooge. I said, okay, are we talking about Scrooge or are we talking about A Christmas Carol? And you said Scrooge. I kept looking around, and it was like messing with my brain. Because everywhere I looked, it was like it was called A Christmas Carol.
And it didn't make matters any better when you opened up your Netflix DVD to say A Christmas Carol, and then you popped it into the player, and on screen it was called Scrooge.
No, even better than that. When I put the thing, when I opened the Netflix thing, the sleeve said A Christmas Carol.
Mm-hmm.
When I put the DVD in, the opening page says A Christmas Carol.
But the title on screen...
The title on screen, when you actually watch the movie, is Scrooge.
Scrooge.
So I was like, okay, can we please just nail down a title? Everybody, let's just call it Scrooge, because this has been messing with me. And I sent Doug a picture last night, a side-by-side picture, the DVD, the Netflix sleeve, and the movie. And I was like, can somebody just pick one? So anyway, it's called Scrooge. Okay, we're going with the on-screen title. We're calling it Scrooge.
This is the movie equivalent of soccer v. football. Oh, this is... Anyway.
Or when or anytime I ever talk to somebody about Star Wars, I can't talk about Star Wars anymore.
No, because you have to say which episode and which one.
I have to say
I know when you say Star Wars, I know you're talking about episode 4, but people that weren't around then don't. No, that there was no subtitle back when it was first originally released.
Goodness gracious. Anyway,
I chose this knowing full well that it would be very difficult to talk about because this story is ingrained in our DNA. Like, I don't think that there's too many people in the world, at least in the first world, that don't know this story.
Right.
It's been made, remade, remade.
Oh my God, the film versions of this.
12,000 different, and there's half-hour cartoon versions, and there's adaptations and reimaginings and
comedy versions, modernizations.
Every type of, and then there's even a movie that came out last year or 2 years ago that was about the writing of it, mm-hmm. called The Man Who Invented Christmas with Dan Stevens, which isn't that good of a movie. And I don't know if you bothered to watch.
I don't remember if I did or not.
That sounds about right. I remember that I did watch it, but I remember not caring a whole lot about it. It wasn't that good. But
it's been approached in animation. It's been approached mm-hmm. in comedy. It's been approached as behind the scenes.
Hell, even the Muppets have done it.
Even the Muppets have done it. it's such a household thing.
Right.
It's really, you
it's
say
like
Scrooge.
The night before Christmas. You know, right. Everybody, you know it.
You know what that is. Mm-hmm. But, it's really, really hard for me to say this is definitively the best one,
mm-hmm.
because all of the versions that I've seen, with the exception of the Albert Finney version, which is a musical, which I hate, is I can pretty much cull from all the versions that I've seen elements that work.
Mm-hmm.
There's very rarely a version of this movie, a film version of this, that doesn't work.
Yeah, it's for living before the invention of motion picture technology, Dickens wrote very cinematically.
Yeah.
Especially in this instance. Because I don't know if you've ever tried to read this.
I read it in high school.
It works better, I think, as in a visual medium.
But it's just very strange to me how ubiquitous this story became. I mean, mm-hmm. like you said, the Muppets have done it. The Flintstones did it. Yogi Bear did it. Sanford and Son did it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you imagine it's so... There's even if you've never seen a film version, even if you've never read the book, you still know this story.
Yeah, yeah. This is one of those that's just it's at this point you emerge from the womb knowing A Christmas Carol.
Yeah, because you know that there are two absolutes when it comes to sorry kids, fictional characters. There are two absolutes. There's an absolute good, which is Santa Claus,
mm-hmm.
and an absolute bad, which is Scrooge. Mm-hmm. So you know those two poles that come with Christmas. And when I read the book, I had read the book after I had seen several film versions of this. And it never fails to touch me.
Yeah, it's always just the genuine goodness of the message is always and every time Tiny Tim is revealed as dying is just gut-wrenching. Mm-hmm. No matter the actor playing Scrooge, no matter the actor playing Tiny Tim, it doesn't matter.
Well, it's like, in, like I said, whenever you see any version of this, even when it doesn't work, there's always an element mm-hmm. that does. I remember the Mickey Mouse version. Mickey Mouse has done this mm-hmm. with Uncle Scrooge.
Yeah. Yeah.
And there's a great moment when the Ghost of Christmas Present takes Scrooge to Bob Cratchit's house.
Mm-hmm.
And he says, "If these shadows remain unchanged, I see an empty chair where Tiny Tim once sat."
Mm-hmm.
And as he says it, his voice echoes off.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of this empty echo. And it's not a very good movie, but that moment works.
Right. Right. And you know, when the Muppets did it, having Michael Caine as Scrooge was the best choice that they made.
I struggled with that. I really did struggle with that movie, because this is a movie that, this is a story that goes so dark.
Yeah.
And so about as dark as you can get.
Mm-hmm.
And the Muppets are so random and so, the Muppets are built on slapstick. So it's a very odd combination when you have the darkness of the Dickens story and the lightness of the Muppets. It's very odd.
See, I thought it worked primarily because Caine plays it straight.
Yeah.
And there's Gonzo as Dickens and Rizzo to pull it back a little bit, but it's not afraid of getting dark. Like, they kill Robin because he's Tiny Tim, and like the design of the three ghosts is mm-hmm. gorgeous,
right?
Especially the Ghost of Christmas Future, just terrifying skeleton and in the robe and everything. But this version always kind of stood out to me. I think after this is the one that a lot of the structure or the lot of the filmmaking was based on, because you notice a lot of shots that are repeated from this in subsequent versions that are not necessarily in previous versions.
Well, we should also mention, by the time this thing came along in 1951, this is a British production.
Mm-hmm.
By the time this thing came along, there had already been 10 versions of it.
Yeah, there had been.
So this was nothing new.
No, no. I think a lot of this, the strength rests in Alistair Sim.
Because he is not playing over the top.
Right.
Which is what Albert Finney did. You know, and
Albert Finney goes over the top?
Albert
never.
Finney, that movie.
Never.
He uses this sort of squeaky little voice that just is annoying. He's ballooning the character up, and you mm-hmm. don't need to balloon this character up.
It's already big enough.
And the thing is, Alistair Sim had such an animated face anyway
mm-hmm.
that inside of him is this performance that comes out that is not, it's not the cranky old man waving his cane.
Right.
It's very, what I got from it was a lot of what Alistair Sim is doing is very psychological.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of the reasoning that he has for hating humanity at large and hating Christmas is all buried within him.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a sense of, how do I put this? He's convinced himself that all of what he's saying is true.
Right. He's taken the good-natured child that he was long, long ago and has basically buried it alive into his inner core, and what has seeped out is just anger and bitterness, and that's all he can remember after a certain point. He needs to be reminded of his own humanity.
Right.
Which is where these spirits come in. And I love the imagery of Jacob Marley.
Oh, my God. Yeah, well, I'll say this first. I don't know if you noticed this, but almost this entire script is pulled from the book verbatim.
Yeah.
And because there are lines of dialogue that you go and you read Dickens' book, and I mean, you can read it line for line. And they're great lines that are repeated.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, when Bob Cratchit says something about, Bob Cratchit says, well, tomorrow is Christmas. And he says, little excuse for picking a man's pocket every 25th of December. Mm-hmm. I've heard that in every single version.
Every single one. Mm-hmm.
Verbatim.
Mm-hmm.
And
I suppose you'll be wanting the whole day off, if it's not too much of an inconvenience. And I'll give you the day, but be here all the earlier still.
You know what's interesting about this? And I can't remember where. I think it comes from A Ghost of Christmas Past. There is a heavy suggestion of why he hates Christmas, or why he dismisses Christmas, because there's a heavy suggestion that he's an atheist.
Mm-hmm.
Because he's cast off all of the... he says something to him. I can't remember exactly what he says, but it's not direct.
Mm-hmm.
But his heart is hardened to the point that his only motivation for getting out of bed in the morning is to make money.
Mm-hmm.
That's it.
Mm-hmm.
Now, there's no more prominent theme in Dickens than that.
Yeah.
Because Dickens had a very, very... was very, very aware of the poor.
Mm-hmm.
Not just the poor, but the poor in England in the 19th century, people who were absolutely down to nothing.
Yeah.
And trying to raise children.
Mm-hmm.
And then...
are there no jails? Are there no workhouses?
And then Scrooge's philosophy, you know, what does he say about surplus?
Oh, they said, but many people would rather die than to go to those places, and he responds with, then they should, to decrease the surplus population.
Yeah, because the Ghost of Christmas Present throws it back at him.
He does.
But...
and it's harsh, too.
He goes home on Christmas Eve, The most interesting character in this story, to me, is Jacob Marley.
Mm-hmm.
Jacob Marley, he's... in good... horror movie form, died 7 years ago this very night.
Mm-hmm.
but Marley is spending eternity with this chain that he forged in life. It's just it's a horrifying
it is and it
he's got all these cash boxes. It's a chain made of cash boxes and ledgers and keys, and he has to drag it around, and it's horrifying, but he's trying to do the one thing he's trying to do one good thing,
mm-hmm.
which is save this man.
I've always wondered, and maybe you have an opinion on this, is he sent back by a deity, or is he sent back and concocts this plan on his own with the other spirits that are out there just to try to save?
I think he did it on his own. Somehow, there's something... I never got the sense that he was... I never got the sense that he was sent. I think he did it on his own. Because he's desperate.
Right. And Dickens was very into the occult, but not necessarily into religion.
Yeah.
So... I can see where the ghosts would be independent actors and influencers from him, instead of being heaven sent.
The version, this version, they do all of this. He does this thing where he tells him, you know, that the three spirits are coming. But he doesn't want him to meet the same fate. There's a weird shot in this version where he goes to the window and he looks out and he sees all of these spirits wandering around. There's a woman sitting there with a baby. They're trying to help her, but they can't. It's a very confusing shot because it's done with very 1950s special effects. And so all you see are these little translucent images just kind of flittering around. I think it was much better visualized, forgive me, in the Disney version. Because when he goes to the window, they look up and they see that all the spirits are chained together. And they're just wandering. They can never be part of this. It's a little more tightly packed there. Here, the visual effect was really confusing. Until you get this tight close-up of this woman sitting out in the snow with an infant. And they're all trying to touch her and they can't.
Right.
But, what I was really struck by in this and in the book is the fact that this scene has some humor in it. He says something about, yeah, he's trying to rationalize why he's seeing a ghost.
Right, you're just a bit of undigested food, some bad cheese.
A bit of bad beef.
Bad beef, you know, and a bit of cheese that hasn't gone all
worse
the way
gravy
down.
than your grave, you know. Yeah. More gravy than gravy. You know. It's like, he's trying to rationalize it, he's trying to work it out. But and he tells him, you know, that you'll be visited, and everybody knows the story. What's interesting to me is the approach to this, because it's very stagey. When he's visited by the ghost of Christmas past, there's a weird transition when they go to the past. It's this very strange transition. It's not necessary, but it's this strange transition where you see a tunnel made of coins with an hourglass spinning in the middle of it. And they do it like 6 times. And honestly, I think this is
That was the time tunnel. I mean, you know, you see it in Doctor Who, and you see it.
Give him a DeLorean, you know, give him a TARDIS, something. The past section is, I think, the most important. Because
it's always the most affecting. Until Tiny Tim.
I don't think we actually meet him in this version as a little boy. We're told that he's in a schoolhouse, but we don't actually see him.
Right. Because they see the light on is deserted, and he goes, it's not completely deserted.
Yeah. Because he's in there.
Right.
But we meet him as a young man. And it's hard to believe that he will become this. It's kind of the Anakin Skywalker thing. It's like this sweet kid. It's hard pressed to believe that he would become this miserly old man. because he's so happy because of his he's there with his sister.
Mm-hmm.
And then later his sister dies.
Mm-hmm.
And I never got the sense that did his sister die because of something he didn't do? I never got that.
I don't recall. That I don't recall.
But
I think he was just deeply affected by her death, or he didn't see her before she died, because he could have gone home or something, and he didn't, and then he didn't get to see her before she died.
Well, he has a relationship with a girl named Alice.
Mm-hmm.
But he gets so involved in the money that he can't, that he sort of rejects the romance that he has with her.
Mm-hmm.
And she accuses him of loving the money more than her. And she I think he leaves her. Does she leave him? I think he leaves her.
Yeah. Either way, he basically he chooses the money. Mm-hmm. He chooses making money and being rich over essentially being happy.
Yeah, because when they break up, the one thing this movie didn't have is a powerful moment that I've seen in just about every other one. Because sometimes in these versions, sometimes he leaves, sometimes she leaves. In the Patrick Stewart version, she's the one that leaves. And there's a painful moment in that one where he gets in front of his younger self and he's yelling, "Go after her!"
Yeah.
You know, there's scarcely any of us who can't think of a memory in our lives when we didn't think, "Why don't you do something?"
Mm-hmm.
But that's, here he largely stays to the side. It is still affecting, but he largely stays to the side. And he tells the spirit, I don't want to be here.
Right. I've always appreciated when she leaves, he's just, in a lot of the ones that have been made, and I'm trying to remember if it's this one too, but he's just kind of hunched over a ledger, and she just leaves and he never sees her again, and he barely even takes notice of the fact that she left.
Yeah.
Because he's just doing his ledgers. And It's you can see from that moment that he's starting to close himself off from everything except.
And maybe that's where the sister's death comes in, because mm-hmm. it's like he doesn't want to feel that pain
right
again. He knows that everybody around him eventually will die, and he doesn't want to feel that pain again. Mm-hmm. There's this one is. The one thing this version does that the other ones don't quite do as much is this one deals with how he became a businessman, or how mm-hmm. he became the businessman that he is. Is that
buying out Fezziwigs and...
Yeah, he buys out Fezziwigs, and basically it's basically the 19th century version of corporate raiding.
Yeah.
Because he makes this bold offer, because they're about to close the firm,
mm-hmm.
Because of a scandal, and he says, "I want to buy 51% of it," and it's this horrible thing that they're doing.
Right, and then they push out between the two of them, Marley and Scrooge, buy the company, 51% of the company. They push Fezziwig out, even though he's the one that took them in as apprentices and basically taught them how to be businessmen. Unfortunately, they didn't take his lessons on how to be men and
how to be human beings.
How to be humans.
There's a heavy emphasis here on humanity first.
Right, because when Scrooge is coming in and the guys there, and he's like, "Do you work here?" And he goes, "Yeah, how much do you get paid?" And I think he said like 4 shillings a week, and he says, "You can stay on at 3.
Okay. pause here. Because this is where I don't know British money.
Oh, okay.
I don't know English money. So when they're talking about pence and shillings and half a crown, I have no idea what any of this is. So it was a little confusing because I'm thinking, is that a lot?
It's not. It's not. It would be kind of the equivalent of like maybe a few dollars a week.
Yeah. Yeah.
Very, very low, very poor wages. When you think about when you read other literature of the time and you read about rich people and they say that they've got £50,000.
Yeah.
Now that's an annual salary, but then that would keep you in the biggest manor in the county for your whole life and the lives of your children and your children's children.
Well, he says to the maid at the end, he says, how much do I pay you? And she says, 2 shillings a week. And he says, well, here, have 10. And I'm thinking, okay, is that a lot?
It's more.
It's more. I don't know English money.
It's hard to explain because it's not the same as it was.
Yeah.
Because in the 70s they converted and like ditched the halfpenny and which is the half euro. A penny. No, they never went to the euro.
Okay.
But they reformatted it based more on the metric system, so by tens instead of the random amounts of things that combined to make pence and pounds and shillings and crowns. And
I assume, you know, because when I'm watching Mary Poppins and they're talking about tuppence, I'm assuming
that's 2 cents. Two cents. Okay. Yeah. Tuppence is 2 cents.
Okay.
But I think a guinea was another name for a pound.
Farthings.
That's really old stuff. Yeah. That's they and half farthings, and they remodulated it and cut out a lot of that stuff in the early 70s. Mm-hmm. So if you watch Monty Python and the Holy Monty Python's Flying Circus, mm-hmm. half of it is they do the old style of money, and half of it they actually did an episode on trying to remember what the new format was.
Really?
Which is what made me look it up, because they were talking about how things had changed, and so I actually found an article that went over how things were broken up and how things are broken up, and you actually have to read about it because otherwise you're just not going to know.
I'll never forget that. I think it may have been the Andy Griffith Show where this Englishman was like, going to pay a fine, and he's like, 2 shillings and tuppence 3 farthings. And the guy says, if that's $2, yeah. But yeah, this whole scene, I'm sitting there listening to them talk about this, and I'm like, okay, the bottom message of this, in the middle of all of this, is basically he's screwing them over.
Oh, sure.
Even though I don't really understand exactly for how much. Because, I'm thinking to myself, in the 19th century, up until possibly the end of the 1980s, you could walk into a corporation with a handful of papers and just destroy that corporation.
Yeah.
Particularly in the 19th century. You could walk in with a legal documentary and say, nice place, I'll take it.
Yeah.
It's so amazing how easy it was to do that.
Mm-hmm.
Now you have legal statutes in place, and you have this and that. And they've tried to make it a little more airtight. But I'm thinking to myself, this is... it's just bizarre how easy that was. Because they're sitting... Marley and Scrooge are sitting across the table from these two guys. They're not saying anything. And their boss is talking to them. Because he's been stealing money from the company.
Right.
And he accuses them of being greedy. And then all of a sudden, Scrooge just comes in and he says, I'll take 51% of the company. And it's like... Do they weigh 45 pounds each? You know? I mean, it's amazing how someone could do that. You couldn't do that now. But anyway.
Yeah.
The message is... Like,
board of trustees and all that kind of stuff.
Oh, God.
The big company. But basically, I've always loved this story, and I gravitate to this, like we were saying, because of Sim. Because this visually, it's not unlike any other version on television, especially around at that same time.
Feels like a dream.
Yeah. Sim is very invested in this in a way that early 50s, older actors in the early 50s were not. Mm-hmm. Specifically British actors in the early 50s. Still reliant on...
Alistair Sim was Scottish.
Scottish. Well...
Still, yeah.
United Kingdom. But the classically trained... British Isles actors, United UK actors, yeah. Were for long after this, because this is right around when Brando and the Method are becoming popular.
Right.
And this was just right on the cusp of when acting in the movies was about to change. And
very theatrical.
Yeah, he does play it theatrically, but he modulates it to be an intimate performance where he just kind of internalizes a lot, mm-hmm. which is not something that you can do on stage.
Right.
At all. Because you can change the way your face looks, and three people in the front row might see it, but the people in the back of the balcony are just going to be like, "Why isn't he talking?" Like, what's going on?
Can't imagine how they did it before microphones.
Well built theaters and very loud actors.
Right. Well. The larger sense of this story and the larger sense of this version, or the more original version, part of this version is given to the fact that we actually get to see how and where Scrooge becomes
Scrooge,
mm-hmm. the hard-hearted businessman that he becomes. His sister died, he had his heart broken. He learned business practices from a very unscrupulous man. Mm-hmm. He learned that in business, money, 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 you have to screw over your friends sometimes because that's just business. Mm-hmm. And in spite of the, and the poor are basically worthless.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have to lend them a hand because the philosophy of Scrooge essentially is, I've crawled my way to the top.
Mm-hmm.
Why can't they?
Right.
Well,
because he's holding them down.
Yeah. Is it a bank that he owns, or is it a lending firm, or?
It's a. You know the mortgage, like savings and loan kind of thing that. The Baileys own in It's a Wonderful Life.
Yeah.
And Mr. Potter is basically like that. Yeah. It's I think it's basically he just deals in mortgages. Mm-hmm. So he's not really a bank. He's a moneylender.
Which he's keeping these people in small wages.
Yeah.
He's basically creating, when he goes out in the street and he sees these poor people in crouched in corners and things like that, the story suggests that he's the richest man in town, essentially. Mm-hmm. Monetarily, he's the richest man in town. And he's creating an environment of poverty. That was definitely the theme of the book.
Right, he's a slumlord.
He's a slumlord, and he's creating an atmosphere of poverty. And his attitude is too bad about them.
Mm-hmm.
And I charge them, I make them pay my rent that they can't pay. If they can't pay it, too bad.
I'll kick them out. And find
out
Somebody who might be able to for a little while longer. I have to give Charles Dickens a lot of credit for a lot of things, but specifically, given the attitudes of the time when this was written, I have to give him credit for not making Scrooge Jewish.
Yeah.
Because it would have been very easy, especially at the time, to make an anti-Semitic statement about moneylenders and very stereotypy.
And it would have been easy to write.
Yeah, it would have been very easy to write. And, you know, he could have been Scroogenstein or something and really gone after, well, he doesn't keep Christmas because he's an evil Jew and all this kind of stuff. I have to applaud Dickens for not going the easy route and presenting to the world that, yes, there are lousy Christians, there are lousy people, and you can't just stereotype.
There are Christians who are greedy. There are Jews who are greedy. Everybody's greedy.
Yeah,
it doesn't matter what your religious affiliation is.
It's human nature and not a cultural thing. So I have to applaud at least that aspect of it, that he didn't take the easy way out.
Yeah.
And
yeah, like
that,
I said,
that's something
earlier,
that you might expect from another writer.
Like I said earlier, I was, yeah, especially the 19th century. Like,
yeah.
I said earlier, I was very surprised. I do not remember if this is part of the book, but the movie or the story suggests very heavily that he has rejected God, that he's now an atheist because, and this is a thing that that comes up, the idea that you know, his sister died, he had his heart broken, he had all these terrible things happen when he was younger, and the question, you know, revolves around his head, where was God in all of this? And the movie, there's one line that suggests this, and it never says it outright. But it's just saying he either rejects God or doesn't believe in God. But you're right. I think that making him Jewish would have been just detrimental. I don't think this story would have had the universal.
It wouldn't have lasted.
It wouldn't have lasted. This is a story very much about who are you and what is your price on humanity. Because the broader outline of this, like I said before, the broader outline of this story is that he is creating a culture with the chain pull of money, creating a culture of poverty, ignorance, and indifference.
And dependence upon him.
Right. Because there's a scene, sometimes it's in the versions of this and sometimes it's not. When he right before the Ghost of Christmas Present is about to leave. The Ghost of Christmas Present opens his coat. Mm-hmm. There are two children wrapped around his leg, mm-hmm. named Want and Ignorance. Mm-hmm. And he says, because the girl is Want and the boy is Ignorance. He says, beware of the boy. And I thought that was a very interesting line.
Yeah.
The symbolism is, and what I always glean from it is, the seeds that you have planted of want and ignorance are still in a childhood, or still in a very young state. Mm-hmm. They haven't quite grown yet to become a weed, but they're very small and they will only grow. Beware of ignorance.
Yeah, regrettably, humanity did not take Dickens' warning.
And, right.
Want and ignorance have spread like wildfire.
Because if you have it...
Not to be insensitive to the people in California who've lost their lives and homes and everything from the wildfires, but it's a viable analogy.
But if you allow ignorance to spread, mm-hmm. ignorance grows like a weed, mm-hmm. and spreads a lot of, and without being cultivated, spreads a lot of very unhealthy ideas, mm-hmm. a lot of unhealthy superstitions.
Mm-hmm. It's how racial prejudices and all forms of bigotry. All forms of bigotry. It's often used by specific political parties or political leanings to keep people voting against their own interests.
Right. And this is something that's come up, is that I've heard arguments from the extreme far right, and sometimes not even the extreme far right, mm-hmm. that this story is essentially socialist.
See, as a democratic socialist, I don't see that it's socialism. I see that it's humanitarianism.
Yeah, I do too.
And, you know, Christian. You know, and as we've established, I am a non-believer, but there is merit in the concept of Christmas and a season of giving that you should keep in your heart all the year long. You know,
is that socialist?
Yeah. It's humanitarianism. It's actually like wanting to be good for the sake of your fellow man. It's wanting to be able to contribute so that other people can contribute what they can.
Yeah.
It's, I mean...
But the idea that this is, and I have actually physically heard it called this, socialism at gunpoint.
I've heard it be called anti-capitalism.
Yeah.
Anti-capitalist, because the rich guy is the bad guy, and it's the same thing that happened with It's a Wonderful Life. In 46, 47, they were saying that it was a communist movie, and it was,
don't make corporations the villain and don't deify the common man.
Right. Because then all of a sudden, oh, it's communist, it's socialist, it's whatever. And it's really just, you know, think about somebody else other than yourself.
Right, and
which is not right. The capitalist way. So I guess in a way, it's kind of anti-capitalist.
But the point is, always be wary of who you are, and the effect that you have, mm-hmm. because, you know, that old saying, the golden rule: he who has the gold makes the rules. That is
true. Thank you, Jafar.
That is true.
Yes, it is.
The more money you have, the more rules you can make. That is very true. I'm sorry, but that's the way it is. Mm-hmm. But the temper of this story is you have to be responsible with it. because in understanding the environment that he's creating, the Ghost of Christmas Present allows him to understand that it has come home.
Yeah.
That the man that he berates for being 5 minutes late to work, the man that he berates for actually, can you believe it, wanting to spend time with his family on Christmas Day.
Mm-hmm.
The bum.
Yeah. You know,
is dying. The family is dying because of you.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that you pay him, you pay him only what he needs to breathe. And the fact that this man can sit at his dinner table. The fact that this man can sit at his dinner table.
And bless Scrooge, the founder of the feast.
The founder of the feast. And can
without,
still...
without his wage, he wouldn't have been able to get anything that was on that table.
Right. Right. Even though he has a son that is hanging on by a thread.
Yeah. The most genuinely good person ever created by pen or evolution is Tiny Tim.
Mm-hmm.
He, God bless us, everyone.
Right. And the idea that this kid will not be there
mm-hmm.
in another 12 months.
Mm-hmm.
By the time next Christmas rolls around,
yeah,
he's not going to be there.
What I love about the ending of this one is that it goes more into the aftermath of Scrooge's transformation.
Right.
Most of them stop at Christmas. Like, he brings them the turkey and he's vowed to, you know, give people raises and whatever, and then it's over. It's all done on Christmas. But this one actually goes into, he paid for Tiny Tim's operation. He becomes like a second father,
mm-hmm.
and he's a mainstay at the Cratchit household. And you get to see that his transformation was not just one day when everything was still fresh,
mm-hmm.
but it was a lasting wake-up call. It was a lasting change.
Because you always wonder, where was Scrooge's head on December 27th?
Right, right.
What I'm interested in is the way they depict this. And again, get used to me saying this, because I keep picking and choosing from every version that there are things that work.
In a way, this is an episode on A Christmas Carol through the ages, more so than the
mounted on this 1951 yeah. version. And by the way, I didn't mention it before, but the Ghost of Christmas Past is played mm-hmm. by Noel Langley, who was a screenwriter,
mm-hmm.
wrote The Wizard of Oz.
Hmm.
But the thing is, it's, as I say, I pick and choose certain things. Even the Disney version. Because the Disney version, the one, now I'm talking about the one with Jim Carrey, is a mess.
Oh, it's terrible.
I'm not going to call it terrible.
I hated it.
I genuinely believe that there's a good, that the story is in there. And there are moments in the movie that do work. Because there's something in this story that I've never seen in another version of this. And that is when the Ghost of Christmas Present, or when the spirit takes Scrooge to Bob Cratchit's house,
mm-hmm.
and everybody in the room knows that Tiny Tim is on borrowed time.
Mm-hmm.
And Bob Cratchit is talking to him, and Tiny Tim is just, he's happy and all of this. And Cratchit knows that he's not going to last very long. Now, Scrooge and the spirit are standing on the staircase. Cratchit turns around and walks up the staircase, and he mm-hmm. stops right in front of Scrooge. And you can see in his eyes this man who's about to lose his son.
Mm-hmm.
And Scrooge is forced to look right into his face.
Mm-hmm.
That's a brilliant way to deal with this, because he has to look at him. He doesn't have a choice.
Even a blind squirrel finds a nut once in a while.
I don't like that movie, but I think there are those little moments that do work. Like I say, I can pick something out of all of them.
Yeah. I mean, it's a universal story. It's a lovely telling of this, you know, perennial, very familiar story.
Where the thing starts to move me is when we get into the third act, when we meet the ghost of Christmas yet to come, because this
that is always the
best representation of it, because when the ghost of Christmas present leaves him, you just hear echoes as he's leaving. Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden he's standing in the street, and the way it's presented is Scrooge is standing there, and all of a sudden in the foreground you just see a hand.
Mm-hmm.
And the hand just stays there, because the ghost of Christmas present, the ghost of Christmas yet to come, does not speak.
Mm-hmm.
And you just see for probably 2-3 minutes just this hand.
Yeah.
And Scrooge is trying to talk to him. He says, I'm guessing you're going to show me the future. And he does. And it's horrifying, because this is where you get taken to the workhouse where his maid is, and they've stolen from him.
Mm-hmm.
They stole the bed curtains while his corpse was in the bed.
And his pajamas.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, his
bed clothes.
His nightgown and everything. Yeah, he's... and all because they don't care about him. Because... Yeah. Why should they be sad that the meanest person in town that is keeping them all under his thumb is dead?
Right. Because they've now stolen all of his money and they can now distribute it amongst themselves.
Right.
And it's just this horrible idea of what people would say about you once you're dead. This horrible idea that, well, he was a miser. He didn't care about us. Why should we care about him?
Mm-hmm.
And because he keeps going to these different places, and it's like,
and he gets to see the businessman who, incidentally, was also the Russian ambassador in Dr. Strangelove.
Mm-hmm.
13 years later, he's
Peter
like,
Bull is a wonderful actor.
You know, I won't go unless there's a luncheon. I mean, I'll go if they feed me.
Because effectively, otherwise... that's what he said to his nephew.
Mm-hmm.
His nephew invited him to dinner. And he's, no, I don't want to do this. I don't want to go. And what I love is the next morning when he wakes up, Ballister Sim, it's like he's gone insane.
He's skipping around and jumping, and it's really kind of delightful, because
he scares the maid to death.
You're right. He's always been a charismatic actor, but when he was in this role, he had to restrain a lot of himself until the end. And he got to bounce and be happy, and yeah, scares the housemaid almost just thinks that he's right for the loony bin. Mm-hmm. And
I love the moment when she runs down the stairs, she kind of trips, and he gets close to her and he says, I promise you, I'm not insane. And then he says, how much do you make a week? And she says, 2 shillings. He said, I'm gonna make it 10, and he puts it in her hand.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just telling her this, he's, you know,
he's
because
doing
he's in
it.
This euphoria, he's doing it. And then, you know, they go and they send this. Was it a goose or was it a turkey? They send to the Cratchit house. I can't remember. But they send the biggest turkey, or they send the biggest goose or turkey, whatever it is, over to the Cratchit house. They don't know where it came from.
They don't know where it came from, but they're holding it like a baby. And
yeah.
The whole time I'm sitting there, I think it was a turkey. I'm like,
this thing is dripping on the floor.
They're not gonna Tiny Tim's not going to die from whatever he has. It's going to be salmonella. They're all they're holding this turkey like it's a baby, and it's like rubbing all over their clothes.
It's 1843. Oh, God. It's 1843. You could probably die from well water. I mean,
I heard a comedian that was like, back then, it's like if you sneezed once and you're like, well, I'm dead. A cold will kill you. It's like, oh shoo, well, I better start getting everything in order.
So what was that? Something, I think it was on Family Guy. It was in the 19th century. It's like, I promise to love you until you die at the age of 32 from a glass of tap water.
Yeah.
But I mean, it's funny. He sends them this giant goose or turkey or whatever it is, and he's basically going around and he's making amends. I can't imagine, because he goes to his nephew's house, I can't imagine how this must look, because on Monday he's an asshole, and on Tuesday he's the most generous man. But what's the scene that always gets me? The scene that always gets me is when Bob comes back to work.
Mm-hmm.
And Scrooge is trying not to look at him. He's trying not to laugh. And he's he calls him out for being late. Mm-hmm. And he says, "You leave me no choice but to raise your salary."
Right, right.
I love that moment. Mm-hmm. Every version of this story gets this absolutely right.
Yeah.
I'm about to raise your salary. Bob's like, what?
I guess I'll go pack up my debt. Wait, what?
Yes, sir. I guess I'll go. What? But it's such a universal story.
Mm-hmm.
The ideas here, the themes here, just think of someone else. Think of other people first. You know, those who have the gold, you know, the golden rule, and you know, just you gotta think of somebody besides yourself,
right?
And it's an interesting story. It's interesting that Dickens had this idea in mind.
Mm-hmm.
You know, looking around and seeing all the street urchins and things like that, and because he wrote about this more than once, because this was a theme all through his work.
He wrote about it a lot.
The world of his books is filled with stuff like this. This is probably
Oliver Twist, Tale of Two Cities, David Copperfield. I mean,
particularly Oliver Twist, because that's about street urchins.
Yeah, Oliver Twist and Tale of Two Cities is very much gets right on the right, literally on the ground. There's a scene right in the beginning when a cask of wine breaks open and people are flooding the street just to lick it up off of the road, out of the dirt. Very evocative, very.
And it has put into our culture a phrase, Dickensian, to mean a society or a situation that is very sour. It's very oppressive. I don't know much about Dickens. I would love to know where this came from. What was it that made him want to write so passionately about this? What was it in his heart that just said, you know, that had such an affection for the downtrodden?
Right. And I think it's interesting because, you know, This book is literally why we have the Christmas that we have.
Right.
Because up until then, it was a minor holiday.
Yeah.
Nobody really cared about it. It was, you know, you got a day off or whatever. People celebrated, but it wasn't like this major thing. Now, Christmas starts in October.
The freaking industrial complex.
like Lewis Black said, when I was a kid, we had Halloween, we had Thanksgiving, and we didn't have Santa sticking his ass into it.
Well, it's funny because the way my holidays work, it starts on October 21st because that's my anniversary. Mm-hmm. And then Halloween. My wife's birthday is November 7th. My birthday is November 14th. And then Thanksgiving. And then the Christmas holiday. So for those months, that's when I'm stuck, essentially. And it all starts on October 21st. So I'm effectively stuck. But it is funny when you go in and you see Santa Claus right there in the middle of the pumpkins.
Yeah. Yeah.
I had Halloween. I had Thanksgiving. And Santa's sticking his ass. Like,
did Jack Skellington design this? Like, what is going on here?
See, I don't mind. I really don't have a problem with if you start putting up Christmas decorations maybe a couple of days before Thanksgiving. I'm okay with that. But when I haven't finished my Halloween candy, when I'm just now buying my Halloween candy, don't start putting Christmas decorations out. I'm not ready for that.
When I went to go get our Halloween candy, this is maybe a week and a half before Halloween, it was already 50% off, like the season had passed.
Oh, even better.
It hadn't even happened yet.
Even better. When I went to Walmart to buy Halloween candy, and I go over there, and there's already a small display starting for Reese's Christmas trees.
Uh-huh.
I was like, you know what? I'm going to buy a bag of these, and I'm going to give them to the trees.
You know what? Screw with them. And are these from last year, or are these new? Does he just have leftover Christmas candy from...
You cheap bastard. Yeah. He just digged these out of a drawer or something.
That's a surefire way for kids to mark your house to not go there on Halloween.
Oh my God. It's really confusing because you got four major holidays crammed into a couple of weeks. Mm-hmm. After 2 months of nothing.
Yeah.
Because I don't actually consider Labor Day a holiday. But
it's a bank holiday. It's not a.
But think about it. From 4th of July to Halloween is basically nothing.
Yeah.
And then from Halloween to New Year's. And then for me, I've got two birthdays and an anniversary peeped on top of that.
Right. See, at least for me, after New Year's, the next thing is my birthday. Mm-hmm. And then my son's birthday in March, and then in April, and my sister's birthday's in March, and her kids are scattered all throughout the year. My one nephew is in December. My niece is in September. One of them's in May. My wife's birthday is in April, and our anniversary is in June, and which is sometimes falls on Father's Day. That's the worst. It's like, okay, which present am I opening? Is this the Father's Day gift or is this the anniversary gift?
But either way, you don't have Santa sticking his ass.
Yeah. I need to find that clip for you. That was that. I love Lewis Black. So what do you have for recommendations based off
of? Okay, I want to recommend something kind of fun. And it's something I sent to you last night. It is a 1979 HBO special called Rich Little's Christmas Carol. And it's a lot of fun. It's basically
because it's Rich Little.
It's Christmas Carol, but he plays all the major roles as celebrities. Celebrity impersonations, if you know who Rachel Little is. I think W.C. Fields is Scrooge.
Oh, I'd like to hear that.
But what's funny is, and you can see it right now, by the way, it's on YouTube. I'll post a link to it. What's funny is Jacob Marley is played by Richard Nixon. Instead of chains, he's wrapped in reel-to-reel tape. And all it is, for like 2 or 3 minutes that he's on screen, it's nothing but Watergate jokes. what was the line? The first spirit will appear when the clock strikes one. The second spirit will appear 18 and a half minutes later. Ebenezer, I've come to save you. Big deal. You couldn't even save yourself. It's a lot of fun. It's silly, but it's a lot of fun. And, it's an hour long, and it's kind of cute. But anyway, what do you got?
Really, I mean, I want to push the Muppet Christmas Carol, because that was originally what I had wanted to talk about, but then
I need to see that again.
It's so good. It really is. The visual design of it is wonderful. I think it's the best Muppet adaptation. Like, you know, when they started doing the adaptations of literature, they've done The Wizard of Oz, they've done Treasure Island, and
Treasure Island was fun.
Treasure Island was fun, but this one was. This was the first film after Jim Henson.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And
maybe that was my problem with it, because I had a real hard time with the voices.
Probably, because what was it? The Family Guy episode. He's like, yeah, Jim Henson had a wait and see attitude, and now we have wrong sounding Muppets.
You guys want to hear a funny ass joke? We're basically right now like Alistair Sim was at the end of the movie. We didn't have this much fun at Superman 3.
No, and that was a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Most of the versions of this, and just, I tend to like Christmas movies.
I do too.
But I also tend to hate Christmas movies. Mm-hmm. The really good ones, you can watch all the time, but then you get, like, you know, Santa Claus versus the Martians. Or Santa Claus the Movie with Dudley Moore. Or
Santa Claus versus the Martians. It's one of those bad movies that... Now, there are bad movies that you can watch. But there are bad movies that are just unwatchable. There are some bad movies, it's like, I can't even watch this for fun.
It's hard to watch some of the ones, even with Riff Trax or Mystery Science Theater 3000.
Yeah.
Over top of them.
You want to see a really, really terrible, and I'll recommend this too. Mystery Science Theater 3000 did a movie called Santa Claus.
That is a weird ass movie.
It's a Mexican kids movie.
It's Satan versus Santa.
Yeah.
And there's that weird thing where they're all singing those weird songs.
Well, they have, say, in Santa's workshop, there are kids from every country. And they keep putting, now this is made in the 1950s, and they keep pointing to the kids, and every time they point to the kids, they're supposed to sing and dance and things like that. But the kids have apparently had no idea why they were there.
There is no energy whatsoever.
They point to the kids, and some of them are just moving around. And they do not know why they're there.
No.
It's bad.
Oh,
it's really bad.
It's terrible. But it's so much fun. So yeah, I'll recommend the Mystery Science Theater 3000 Christmas specials. Santa Claus versus the Martians.
And I'll recommend Rich Little's Christmas Carol, because it's on YouTube. Again, you can find it. I have a link. There's a link here for it.
And The Christmas That Almost Wasn't from the last the previous season.
My favorite version of that was on The Simpsons, when the teacher didn't want to teach, so she just showed the kids The Christmas That Almost Wasn't, but then was.
Yeah.
The only good part of it was the DVD broke. Anyway.
I just saw a poster for Prancer, and I haven't thought about that movie in years.
Ugh. I haven't thought about that movie at all. It's like, well, those movies that just pass by, and I'm like,
I saw it once a year in elementary school, like the day before Christmas break.
Mm-hmm.
Like we would all sit uncomfortably on the floor in front of a 32-inch television, rolled in, lights turned off, and we're supposed to just sit and watch this mediocre to crap movie.
Prancer, call me when you get to Rudolph, okay? It's like going to, see Kiss, and the only person there is Peter Criss. Okay? Call me when you get to Gene Simmons, okay? Just, I don't care about, the thing says, what would Christmas be like without him? I said, it'd still be Christmas. It just wouldn't have a reindeer named Prancer.
Yeah.
Is this...
And if you're in the mood for some old school bullying and misogyny, Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, the Rankin-Bass.
Yeah, those are rough. Those are hard to sit through.
What do we have coming up?
Next week, we're going to talk about loneliness. We're talking about one of my favorite movies of all time, Christmas or not.
Because that's a big switch from the month so far.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. Lesbians at Christmas was kind of, you know.
There's still a healthy dose of loneliness.
But we're talking about Billy Wilder's great 1960 film that won the Oscar for Best Picture.
And it was the last black and white movie to do so until Schindler's List in 1993.
It is called The Apartment.
It's so good.
Oh. Such a wonderful movie. I love this film.
Jack Lemmon, Shirley MacLaine,
Fred McMurray
in the sleaziest role.
Oh my god! Oh, just the Fred McMurray plays this. Oh, he's this married man, and he's having a relationship with this elevator girl, and he kind of blows her off.
And then you think that he was the one. He was the model dad on My Three Sons.
He plays a good schmuck. He does. He really plays a he's a good villain. But yeah, that's next week, and then our post Christmas hangover, we're going to talk about the Thin Man series.
Yay!
Which you have chosen.
I have.
There are six of these. I have now worked my way through four of them. And there is a declining quality.
Yeah, but they're all delightful. I think a lot of the, and we'll talk about this when we talk about them, but they're all able to be entertaining because they were so long in between making them.
And so many things going on.
Right. So they were able to leave and come back after a certain amount of time and make something that was not a rehash of the last one.
Right.
Each one of them is unique. They're not all spectacular, but they're all fun.
Yeah. Although you can notice a dip in quality probably after they have a child.
Well,
life
is never the same after a child.
I haven't gotten to the last two yet, but I'm getting there. But anyway.
Anyway, I think that wraps it up here. For us on the Pod Bay Doors. You can find all of our back episodes on www.thepodbaydoorspodcast.wordpress.com. You can find us on Twitter at pod_bay. You can throw a virtual tip into our virtual tip jar, actually a real tip into our virtual tip jar, at Patreon at pod_bay. We thank you very much for listening in, and the pod bay doors are now closed.
The mission has been completed.
Happy Christmas, Kyoko.
Happy Christmas,
Julie. So this is Christmas. What have you done? Another year over, and you won't just be gone. And so this is